Hey, KJ, Kevin Jackson joins me now. How you doing, Kevin?
Good to talk to you, Lars. It's been a minute, man. Where you been?
Well, I was at CPAC. I looked around for you, and you're almost always there, and I didn't see you there.
I didn't go this year because I talked to Matt, and I wanted to get there. I wanted to do a panel. You know, look, we got all this race tension in America. We got all this just tension in general, conservative versus liberal, man versus woman, black versus white. And I wanted to do a panel to talk about this and empower a bunch of the younger kids and stuff. And, you know, these guys, I don't know, I have nothing against CPAC, but honestly, I'm sick of kind of the same old, same old. Now, I understand we have the presidential stuff, but it's, you know, and those are good. You had a lot of candidates going through there, but the things that happen when you're not on the main stage is where I think you have a chance to learn, and they just don't seem to care about that.
Unfortunately, that's probably true. I go because I get access to some interviews, and sometimes I like to see people in person. But let's get to what's going on in the GOP. You've got Mitt Romney running around as the loser of two tries at the presidency, trying to say, we've got to have anybody but Trump. Why is the party trying to self-destruct and trying, it sounds like, to poke the voters in the eye by saying, by the way, you don't pick the candidate for president, the nominee. We do it. We, the powerful power brokers within the GOP.
Well, you know what, Lars, a lot of these guys, and I've learned this going to a couple of the conventions, is that going in a room full of Republicans that have come through the establishment ranks, and it's like watching wolves in the wild. You know who runs the wolf pack, and you know who's the Zeta wolf, you know, the one that's going to eat last and the whole deal. You don't have to watch very long to see what the pecking order is. And these guys are taught from the time they become college Republicans to the time they run for the first office that you must worship at the altar of the GOP. And so when they come up through those ranks, any interloper, whether it's Donald Trump or it's a guy like Cruz or some Tea Party candidate running for office in New York or, you know, Christine What's-Her-Face or whatever, you're going to get the GOP that just has a conniption because they all look at it as, we've been in the pecking order. I've been here 5 years. This guy's been here 18 years. And everybody's waited their turn, and here's a guy disrupting this. And it was the same with me. I would talk to Republicans around the country. One guy actually said this to me, Lars. He said, you know, you came out of nowhere. Why are people listening to you? And he said, I've been doing this. He told me this. He said, I've been doing this for 20 years. And my comment was, well, you know what? If you've been doing it 20 years and I came out of nowhere and I'm already doing it better than you, you should be learning from me.
Yeah, exactly. In fact, shouldn't the party welcome that kind of disruption? Because that kind of thing is how you really grow, I think. When you say, that's thinking outside the box. What you described with that pecking order, that's a box. And you said, and I think what makes people uncomfortable is all that power brokering that goes on in D.C. Because I had a caller earlier today who said, why is this happening? I said, well, I said, usually if I had wanted in my 20s to get into political, you know, running for office, I'd have had to run for city council, county commission, run for the state legislature. And as I worked my way up through the ranks, it would be made clear, this is where you fit in. And by the time you get to congressman or governor or whatever, you owe about 1,000 different people, maybe 10,000 people.
You got worn out knees and chapped lips. You know, let's just face it, you've been begging and you've been, you know, kissing a lot of butt. And at the end of the day, think about it, you know, these people, I mean, I don't get mad at them because I understand it, but it's almost with military. You go through the chain of command. You don't go around the chain of command. And the only way you get ahead is if somebody gets ahead of you and they bring you up and so on and so forth. It is truly military-like in how things happen. And you're right. Here comes somebody that goes, it's almost union, too. Think of it that way, where a guy comes in, he hasn't been in the union, and he's like, you know what, we can do this a lot more efficient this way. And they're saying, shut up. We've been doing it this way for 25 years, or, you know, for generations. They don't want it. And the fact of the matter is you're right. They should be embracing the change, embracing the newness of what this is. And I'll admit, and I think a lot of your listeners would say this, Donald Trump's a bit of a loose cannon. Cruz may even be considered a bit of a loose cannon. But sometimes you need that. I was thinking about the media presence that Donald Trump has because we've always been slaves to the media. This is a guy who truly is controlling the media. It's not always in his favor. but it always works out in his favor in some kind of way, because he's able to get them to put the attention on him. I want people to think about this for 1 second. If he's the guy, how much media will Donald Trump draw in, and what kind of pressure can he put on Hillary Clinton when he says things that wakes people up the same way he did with immigration and with Muslims, and he starts calling her out for the things that she's done? Can you imagine if Donald Trump says, look, I've run a lot of businesses, but I've never made money on a foundation where there's such a direct tie between my $500,000 speech and what happens legislatively? I mean, he could put a lot of pressure on her.
Well, see, and Kevin, I think even one step beyond that, not that you're wrong, but I think when he confronts a problem like the VA that's ignoring veterans till they die while they're waiting in line, and everyone else says, well, you know, I've looked at it and there's really nothing we can do because all the rules and all the regulations prohibit us from firing anybody. Can you imagine how a Donald Trump might light one of those bureaucracies on fire and use the media at that point? I mean, he's the kind of president I would almost expect him to show up in Phoenix, walk into the VA with a trail of cameras behind him, and say, are you folks going to start giving care to these veterans or not? And if you're not, I want you to tell me so on camera. And if you tell me you're not going to do it, I'm going to find a way to fire you, even if it costs us a few bucks. We're going to fire you. Now, imagine applying that kind of approach to the problem, to some of the bigger, thornier issues of government.
Well, see, that's where I'm coming back to where the media comes in, where you, as opposed to talking about it and holding congressional hearings and things like that, Trump's got a whole group of people following it behind him, and he's calling scapegoats out on camera, and he's saying, oh, so we can't, and somebody's trying to explain, well, Mr. Trump, well, President Trump, we can't fire. He's like, what do you mean we can't fire this guy? This guy's a total incompetent. He's stupid. He's ignorant. You know, and he goes into that. You know, I can't imagine, we call it in the vernacular, putting him on Front Street. I can't imagine putting some guy on Front Street like that.
The Lars Larson Show.